support from a whole range of people. Momentum, the Labour Party, the Socialist Party, Left Unity, and a whole range of individuals who are putting a great deal of work to make this happen. We're here because the health service faces a perfect storm this winter. Decades of cuts and privatisation and sell-offs have brought the NHS to the brink of this current situation.
True.
Brink of disaster. The health service is underfunded, is understaffed, and it's under attack. But the difference is, we're ready to fight. We're here to fight to defend our health service. We will not let it go without a fight.
Yay! Yay!
We have an excellent range of speakers here today, and we're going to start straight off with Justin Madders, MP, who's the Shadow Secretary of State for Health, and he's going to introduce his comments on the current state of health service. Justin.
Thank you, Tony. A little bit of a promotion there. I'm Shadow Health Minister, not Secretary of State now. But maybe one day. So, this is the 70th year of the NHS, 70th birthday this year. As we know, it was formed in the post-war years out of the devastation of the Second World War, and the principles of a universal public owned health service through the point of use were established. And wasn't it an amazing journey that we've been on, to the point where we got to in the last few years where the NHS became the envy of the world, and people all over the world, including in the Olympic ceremony, saw just what this country thought of the NHS, just how proud we are of the NHS and the people who work within it. Indeed, until the end of 2010, we had record low waiting lists, record satisfaction levels from patients, and years upon years of sustained investment. But since then, things have taken a turn for the worse, decidedly so, in fact. We know that this year we have had another winter crisis, following on from last year's winter crisis, when the Red Cross came in and said that this was a humanitarian crisis. And I think that was nothing of an understatement, but actually the general consensus from the clinicians, from the patients, from the think tanks, and from the politicians is that this year is a lot worse than last year. In fact, it's probably the worst that we've seen for a couple of decades. And that isn't coincidence. That's what happens when you get year upon year of underinvestment in our health service. So why have we got to where we are today? We've actually been in a permanent winter crisis for about 3 years now. The A&E waiting targets haven't been met since the summer of 2015, as we heard in the press this morning. Even the NHS admit they're not going to be met for at least another year. Frankly, I don't think they're going to be met ever again under a Conservative government. We know that waiting times for operations are going up, and indeed one of the consequences of the winter crisis was that every operation was postponed to the month of January, which is going to cause a lot of discomfort and a lot of pain to patients who've been waiting for their operations. It's also going to cause financial consequences for hospitals, as they rely on the income from these operations to keep afloat. And every trust virtually in the country is in deficit now, because they've been asked to do the impossible, and we've got to end this cycle of underinvestment. So where do we get to from a very healthy position in 2010? Well, we started with some very poor decisions at the start of the coalition government in terms of staffing. They decided to cut the number of nurse training places. They decided to introduce a pay cap, which is still in place, and although they're now saying it might be lifted, there is no certainty about that, because what we've got as a result of underinvestment in our staff is a very demoralised workforce. We have nurses having to go to food banks because they can't make ends meet on their NHS wages. And we've got the obscenity of agencies taking billions and billions of pounds out of the NHS, because actually that's where the staff can only be got from now. There are huge gaps across the board. We've got 3,500 midwives short of the numbers that we need. And last year, over half of all maternity units had to be shut at some point or other, and that was quite often due to staffing shortages. We're 40,000 nurses short in this country. Only last week, there was a recruitment exercise in the Thames Valley area, which is where Theresa May lives, and they were looking to recruit about 2,000 nurses. Can anyone guess how many they actually recruited? Five. Five out of 2,000. I mean, that just brings home to you how difficult it is to get people into the NHS. And as we know from the headlines in the Chronicle this week, there are also issues in Chester and the Countess there, and that's one of the very nicest, most attractive places to work in the country, and even they are struggling to recruit. This is what happens when you get 8 years of pay restraint. This is what happens when you ask people to do more and more with less and less, and actually it's getting to an untenable situation. And to top it all, we're not even recruiting for the future. The government have decided to scrap nurse bursaries, which means that nurses now, if they want to qualify as a nurse, have to pay £9,000 a year just to go into hospitals and train. They're actually working in there for around 30 hours a week. They're actually part of the team. They're actually contributing to our health service, and they're paying for the privilege of doing that. It's an absolute obscenity, and it's got to stop. So what we've seen as a result of that is that the number of applications for nurse training places has gone down by 23%. The government said scrapping the bursaries would lead to more people training to become nurses. It's gone the other way, and it's not a surprise, and Labour will pledge to reintroduce the nurse bursaries. And at the heart of this is a staffing crisis, and I would say that I don't for a minute blame the doctors, the nurses, the porters, the cleaning staff, everyone who works in the NHS for where we are now. It is absolutely not their fault. They are doing heroic work despite the pressures that are being put on them. And it's only because of their goodwill that this crisis has not become a catastrophe. So actually, we need to really thank them for everything they do and give them some hope. And it's not just in the actual NHS itself that the problems are arising. More and more people are coming to A&E because of cuts to social care. There's been over £6 billion taken out of social care in the last 8 years. And we see the consequences of that on a regular basis. We see the person who's discharged too soon because a care plan isn't in place, and they end up back in A&E a week later. We see bed spaces being taken by people who are actually fit to go home, but because there is no care plan in place, they're kept in hospital longer. Both of those situations contribute to the pressure and the demand on staff. And actually, what we want to see is some real investment in our social care sector and an end to the cuts that have decimated that industry for the last 8 years. And we also have had some damaging legislation changes as well. If we go back to 2012, the Health and Social Care Act has been an absolute disaster. Who can remember David Cameron back in 2010 saying, "I'm not going to reorganise the NHS"? Well, he lied, because that's exactly what he did. He brought in the Health and Social Care Act, which completely transformed the architecture of the NHS. It forced everyone to go out onto tendering exercises, and over £3 billion has been wasted on accountants and lawyers and tendering exercises, which means that the likes of Virgin Care can now get their hands on our health services. And they have the temerity to actually sue the NHS when they don't get what they want. That money should be spent on patients, not on lawyers and private health companies. And at the bottom of all this is the funding decisions that have been taken. Now, traditionally, demanding the NHS means that you need to increase investment by about 4% a year as a result of the ageing population, increases in health costs and advances in technology. And that's why up until the last decade we had a health service that really was the envy of the world. But in the last 8 years, those increases have averaged about 1% a year. So you can do the maths. You only increase spending by 1% a year when you need to do it by 4% a year. It's no wonder that we get to the situation where we are now. And there'll be people who say, well, this means that we can't carry on with an NHS as it is. But I don't agree with that at all, because it is a political choice not to invest in the NHS. It is a political choice to give £1 billion to the DUP to bribe they're supporting Parliament. It's a political choice to reduce corporation tax to record low levels and use that when the money could have been used for the NHS. It's a political choice to reduce our inheritance tax for the very richest in society. And that is the argument that we need to make to people. It is not about whether the NHS is sustainable to the future. It's about what political choices we make as a country and as a government to fund the NHS for the future. And I, for one, say that we, if we get back in, we will have a Labour government that will make that political choice to invest in the NHS to the levels that it needs. So, if we're back in, £5 billion a year immediately will be injected into the NHS. We're going to end the public sector pay cap. We're going to restore nurse bursaries, and we're going to find £10 billion of capital funding so we don't have hospitals and surgeries falling apart around our ears. And then we should give people a bit of hope, a bit of confidence that actually the NHS's decline is not inevitable. There's enough people out here, the public support it, the patients support it, the nurses and doctors support it. There is the will there if we have a Labour government to give it the way. So let's keep fighting for the NHS and let's give it a future that it and we deserve.
Thank you very much, Justin. I'm sure most of you here will join me in wishing Justin and the rest of the Labour Party the best of luck in getting rid of the Tories and getting us a government that's going to show more concern for the health service. And I would add that such is the feeling on this issue, such is the Tories, the contempt that people have seen, that, you know, cutting the health services in the Tory Party's DNA, and people know that. And I say that the Labour Party to stand clearly on stopping all cuts and reversing privatisation, unambiguously, they would win the election on that issue alone. So, good luck, Justin. So we'll go on now, and the next speaker is Seth Horsu, who's from the, if you like, the front line. He's a NHS junior doctor. Seth.